Hare Krishna. Question from Krishnanam Prabhu. What is the exact difference between the mind and the intelligence? When I am chanting, I realize that many thoughts come in the mind and planning goes on in the background. And when I come back to awareness, I start wondering, what is this happening? Is the intelligence meant to control the mind, or is it the mind controlling the intelligence? And how do we exactly differentiate between the two? And how do we apply this knowledge for our chanting? Answer: the chain of command or control can go both ways. Can go from the intelligence down to the mind and senses, or it can go up from the mind and senses to the intelligence. If we consider the chariot body metaphor, ideally the charioteer is meant to control the horses through the reins. But if the charioteer is weak or inattentive or incompetent, then the horses may run wild and the charioteer will be dragged along. So in that case, the horses will be controlling, dragging the charioteer along also. So Krishna talks about both these possibilities. For example, in 2.67 in the Bhagavad Gita, Indriyanam hi charatam yan mano anvidhiyate tadasya harati pragyam vayurnavam ivambasi. So Indriyanam hi charatam, senses are wandering, like the horses are going wild. And then yan mano anvidhiyate, when the senses are wandering, the mind focuses. That means the reins go loose. And then tadasya harati pragyam, the word pragya is very close to intelligence. It's like buddhi. So the intelligence gets carried away. So that happens. Now, that is how things can happen. But then Krishna also says that, what should we do? He talks about the hierarchy in 3.42 when he says, Indriyani paranyahur indriyebhya param manah manasastu para buddhe yo buddhe paratastu saha. So he says, Indriyani paranyahur, about that matter, about the senses of the, about that matter, insentient matter of the senses, about the senses of the mind, indriyebhya param manah manasastu para buddhe. There is the soul, intelligence, and above them, yo buddhe paratastu. So above them is the soul. So clearly, intelligence is above, and then Krishna expects us to use the intelligence to control that which is lower. That he says in the next 3.43. Evam buddhe param buddhva. With intelligence, know that you are beyond all these, and therefore, by situating yourself in spiritual knowledge, with spiritual strength, evam buddhe param buddhva samsthabhyatma namatmana. So the mind, Atmanam Atmana, the mind, one Atma refers here to the mind, other to the soul. Fix the mind on the soul. That means don't let the mind go downwards and dwell on sense objects and get attracted there. Let that mind turn upwards and fix it on the spiritual reality and thereby conquer lust. Jahi Shatrum Mahabaho Kamarupam Durasadam. In this way, conquer lust, Krishna says. So essentially, the point which Krishna is making here is that the chain of command is meant to go upwards. The intelligence should control the mind and senses. Even the senses are pulling down, but the mind should be turned upwards with knowledge of our transcendental identity. And that way we situate ourselves on the spiritual platform. So that's the answer to the first question about who is to control whom. Yes, the intelligence is meant to control the mind. But then sometimes the mind may control the intelligence if it gets carried away by sensory images or perceptions. And now, we can strengthen the intelligence by scriptural study, by philosophical conviction. And then it's when the charioteer is strong, and it's not just a matter of strengthening, but it's also a matter of training. Now, just because a person is a bodybuilder doesn't mean that the person will be able to be a good charioteer. The person has to be competent. So we have not just get a lot of scriptural knowledge, but we also need to know how to apply, get the training to apply that scriptural knowledge for for controlling the senses, for the charioteer to say can use the reins and control the horses. So like that, we have to get the training, and that training comes by scriptural study, by inquiring from devotees, by observing our own consciousness. So Now, there's another Gita article, look at the mind before you look with the mind. It's whenever my mind wants to look at, wants us to look somewhere, instead of just looking over there, we first look at the mind. Is what we think makes sense? And then we decide whether to look in that direction or not. So that way, we can reposition the mind not as the subject of knowledge, but as its object. How do we apply all this while chanting? So, is there a difference between the mind and intelligence? Definitely. From the functional point of view, there is a big difference. The mind is driven by short-term emotions, instant pleasures, and the mind often runs on predictable patterns based on whatever has given pleasure in the past. And it runs also on the predictable patterns of wanting to avoid whatever has caused some inconvenience or misery in the past. So what do? We use our intelligence. So intelligence essentially means the faculty to make conscious, rational, scripture based decisions. And the buddhi, the mind refers to the faculty for emotions, which generally is short term, often instantaneous. So now, how do we differentiate between the two? One simple criteria is that if there is the inner voice which is telling us to do something which is contrary to scripture, we can understand that is the voice of the mind. And if there is an inner counsel, inner voice urging us to do that which is right, which is according to scripture, we understand that is the voice of the intelligence. And further, as we become more and more purified, we will be able to differentiate between these voices more and more clearly. Till then, it may be a little difficult, and that's why till that time it's good to have our life relatively structured. That means if we decide that every day I wake up and do my chanting, then if that's what I've decided, even the mind says, okay, come on, read the newspaper, come on, watch the TV, come on, do this, do that, I'm not going to do this. We don't leave much room for the mind to drag us and to mislead us. And there, so Prabhupada also writes in the Kamesha Krodesha purport 3.37 that by one can rise from ignorance and passion to goodness by the method of regulated living and acting. And Prabhupada says in the NOI introduction also that once we come to know goodness, then how to make further advancement will be revealed subsequently. That means that once the inner landscape becomes less hazy and more clear for us, then we'll understand, okay, this is the voice, this is impure, voice is the voice of the mind, I won't listen to it. But till then, when it's difficult for us to differentiate, we try to focus on just doing what the scripture tells us to do and arrange our life so that it becomes easier for us to do what scripture tells us to do. So during chanting, when the mind starts wandering too much, it can be helpful to try to strengthen our intelligence. So that we will have the alertness and the determination, the strength to check the mind whenever it starts going here and there. So maybe before chanting, we can maybe recite some very inspiring verse about the glory of the holy name, or we can meditate on some scriptural passage or some point we have heard in some class or read somewhere where, which gives us impetus to fight against the mind, which gives us impetus to strengthen ourselves. And then with that, and we can feel more confident, more determined to tackle the mind. And also, if we find the mind wandering too much in chanting, then it may be helpful to take a break. Not a long break where we just walk away and do something else entirely, but just a short break, maybe to take a few deep breaths or just recite some sweet verses, or maybe even sing the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra in a tune. So basically to get us out of the mind-induced haze. Because if we are too much in the mind-induced haze, then one of the strategies the mind uses us is that it allows us to continue the external activity externally while disconnecting our consciousness from it internally. And that sort of chanting is not very fruitful. So taking a break or a slight pause, which helps us to reorient ourselves in our our consciousness to that can help us to again reconnect with the holy name and chant better. So chanting essentially is a war, and we cannot go with a rigid predetermined strategy in a war. It depends on how the enemy attacks, and we have to find the right weapon for the kind of strategy with which the enemy is attacking to counter that strategy. So somebody would say, you just sit down at one place and chant 16 rounds attentively without getting up or doing anything else. Yes, that is good if we can do that. But if we are sitting just for the sake of sitting and the mind is wandering all over the universe, then maybe just getting up, standing or walking and chanting might be better. Or just maybe putting some water on the face. That might be better. So I'm not recommending breaks in chanting by saying this. Rather, there are already breaks in chanting because of the mind. And what we are trying to create by taking physical breaks is create a break in the mind spell so that we can actually resume our chanting. So rather, so every day we need to observe and learn, okay, how can I concentrate, how can I connect with the holy name, and thereby we can become more and more effective in our chanting. So in general, that faculty within us which helps us to act according to scripture, that is the intelligence, and that faculty which wants us to act contrary to scripture, that is the mind. Thank you. Hare Krishna.